My youth is yours, run away now and forever. My youth is yours, the truth so loud you can't ignore my youth. My youth, my youth, my youth is yours.
Mother's Day, good Mother's Day. No, good morning and happy Mother's Day. Good Mother's Day, right? Just shh, that's one cup of coffee for you. Well, we're so glad that you're here. Today, I do have the privilege of concluding the six-week series that we're in, Love, Marriage, Baby, Carriage. And so we're going to bring that one home. Now, 22 years ago, I was getting ready to give birth to my first son, Samuel. And our church at the time threw a shower for us, a baby shower. And I received some different gifts and stuff, very helpful. But one of the gifts that I treasure to this day that I received is this gift called Love You Forever. It's a book by Robert Munch. Have you read that? Yes. Okay, so those of you that know where I'm going to go with this one. Okay, so anyway, in this book, it's about a mother who's continuously loving her son through all the stages of his childhood, you know, from when he's a baby to adolescence, to, you know, to adulthood. And there's this behavior that she engages in that repeats itself throughout the book. And it's every night she'll rock the baby and she's, you know, to sleep, and she sings to him, I love you forever, I like you always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be, right? So this parent, this mother, goes through taking care of her child, and it indeed is very hard for her to like him, especially during adolescence, right? And stuff. So we see the unfolding and all. And then this child, this adolescent, grows into a young man. And he moves out of the house and he has his own, right, house. And then you see the mother. This is hilarious. She sneaks back to his house. She goes upstairs. She picks him up while he's sleeping and she puts him in the rocking seat. And she starts rocking to him and singing that song to him again, right? So it signifies the deep love that a mother has for her child. Now, this is where the book catches me off guard. Anyway, eventually the mom becomes too old and too sick to carry on the tradition, right? So in turn now you see the son coming to the mother's house, and he picks up the mother and he takes her to the rocking chair and he starts to rock her and he sings the song, but this time he says to her, I love you forever, I like you always, as long as I'm living, my mommy you'll be. And the book shows you where she dies. And so the son returns home and he goes to his daughter's room and he picks up his little daughter and he goes to that rocking chair and he starts rocking her and giving that tradition where he starts to sing to her. Now, this book so captured my heart because it really gave me the perspective of parenting, that it indeed is a full circle to it. And so I love this book. This book meant a lot to me. And so I bring it to you today as the backdrop for discussing with you my topic, which is aging parents. So why don't you bow your heads with me, and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to come. Thank you, Father. Lord, I ask that you just wake us up, wake up my mind, Father, and cause me, Lord, to hear your voice and yours alone. I thank you, Father, that you have this word for us today, and I ask that you would open our hearts to receive it, that we would be keen to hear what it is that you want. I thank you, Lord, that you have a plan and a purpose for each person's life, and you brought them in. They might have been invited by somebody today. They might have came because it's Mother's Day, whatever, but I know you have an appointment for them to stand before you, and you want to talk to them. So the authority you've given me, I just bind the enemy in the name of Jesus, that your words would be completely and utterly heard here. So Holy Spirit, come. Come and have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, most of us, we do think, or we do have this intuitive feeling that we should do something as our parents get older, you know, to kind of help give back to them, to care for them somehow. And so intuitively, we kind of know that, right? But I want to tell you that the Bible actually says that the way we treat our parents is deeply important to him, is deeply important to God. Matter of fact, he made it one of the commandments. In Exodus 20:12, it says, honor your father and your mother. And here you go, the promise. Then you will live a long, full life. Now, I want you to circle that word honor. That word honor in Hebrew actually is talking about something very weighty, something very important. So to be able to honor one's parents, you have to treat them or recognize them as being important. And for most of us, we grew up with parents that were, they were good parents, right? They weren't perfect parents because none of us are perfect. We're not perfect parents and we didn't have perfect parents. But we grew up with good parents who tried their very best. And then there are a few of you that grew up with parents who were neglectful, abusive, and hurtful. Yet when I read this scripture about honoring your mother and father, I don't see a differentiation based on how the performance of a parent. I just see that command to honor. So what is God getting at here? Is he saying that somehow we're to ignore pain if we receive that from a parent, or we're endorsing that they've got good parenting skills when we didn't think so? Is that what he's saying? No, I don't think so. I think God is saying here that we are to honor the position of parenthood, that we are to honor the position of parenthood. You have three sources of authority in your life: the home, the church, and the government. And those three sources have roles to play in our lives, and they lay down a foundation of an orderly society. And so I believe that God says he wants us to honor this role, this position of parenthood, regardless of the personality that was behind it. It reminds me of when I go before a judge and I say, "Your Honor," right? "Your Honor." I'm not commenting on his or her character, right? I am giving that word, "Your Honor," because I am showing respect for the position at which it stands. And I think that's what God's getting at here. He wants us to honor the position of parent. Now, let me also say, if you have a home life where you did have a parent that was abusive or neglectful and things like that, you are not exempt from following this command. You're just not. But I'm going to throw out the caveat also that you're going to need to have these extra strong boundaries and clear understandings of what is expected of you, okay? And you'll need people to help you to figure that out. You see, caring and honoring for a parent is going to look different for each and every one of us in here. And so we need to know that, and we need to approach that. Now, honoring of a parent is a central idea of our Christian faith. It's a central idea here. And so we see no greater example of this idea than what Jesus Christ did as he was dying on the cross. He remembered his mother. Look on your outline. John 19:26, it says, "When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved," he's talking about John, "standing nearby, he said to his mother, 'Dear woman, here is your son,' and to the disciple, 'Here is your mother.' From that time on, the disciple took her into his home." And so what we see here is that when Jesus is dying for all mankind on the cross, right, he's suffering this enormous physical and emotional and mental and spiritual pain because he's separated from God. While all that is going on, he turns and he makes sure that his mother is cared for in her old age. And if you have any doubt of the importance of honoring your parent and taking care of them in their old age, I think Jesus Christ just settled it right there for us, right? See, it's not just a good thing or an intuition. It is a godly thing to do this. This is a godly thing. So then the question becomes, how? How do I honor my parents? How do I honor them, especially as they get old? You know, we don't exactly have training, do we, or coursework on working with the aging parent. And it becomes overwhelming. And I'm a lot like you. I'm a fellow struggler and learner of this. So when I got this topic, I began to pray about it. I searched the scriptures, and I was asking the Lord for help, and he said, "Turn to your elders in your church." And so I did do that. I turned to elders and leaders in my church and that I knew that went through or were going through being able to give care to a parent, an aging parent. And I said, "Would you come and let me interview you? Would you let me talk to you about how you honor your parents?" And so for today, what I've prepared for you is these interviews, these series of interviews with principles that I saw that I've gone and listed them on your outline, and I want to talk to you about them today. Now, these folks that will be speaking, they give you their name because they are part of our fellowship here. They're part of our family, and they want you to know they're here to help you when you walk through this. So look on your outline. Let's look at how to honor parents, some of the decisions we have to make to be successful in this. The first decision we have to make To honor a parent is, I will meet their needs. That you're going to meet their needs. That means you're going to decide that, yes, that is part of what God is wanting me to do. And so I'm going to be on the team to meet that aging parent's needs. And we see this in Matthew 7:12. Jesus gives us the golden rule. He says, do for others as you want them to do for you. This is a summary of what is taught in the law and the prophets. And so we do to others as we want them to do to us. This is the backdrop at which you approach an aging parent, right? You have this concept. So it's really simple. I'm going to suggest that you just stand back and you go, when my kids grow up, how do I want them to treat me? What do I want to do, you know, have them do for me? And so you start asking yourself those questions. Do you want them to come in and rush in and take all your control and your house away and your car and all? No. You want them to partner up with you. So whatever you expect of them is what you're going to do for your parent. Now, to show you how this works, his first video is of Bob Hutchinson, again, a leader in our church, and he had the challenge of taking care of his elderly mother. Take a look at this.
Well, I'm Bob Hutchinson. I've been at Vineyard Community Church for 16 years now. We came in very shortly after y'all came into the new building, and we've been up to our eyeballs in Vineyard ever since. Well, my mother, Virginia Lee, is 100 years old. She'll be 101 in June. And we're very fortunate in that she really is in very good health. She uses a walker. She's a little unsteady on her feet, but her mind is clear. Her appetite is good. Her general health is good. So we have a lot to be thankful for. But she doesn't do much for herself, so I have to do a lot of things for her. But Mom has been with us now for about 5 years. I had originally planned to have Mom come and live with us much before that, but she had this huge home in Gloucester full of everybody's mementos for four generations back, and she just couldn't pull herself out of it. It wasn't until she had a couple spates of illness that we actually got her here. But prior to that, we had to redo our home. So we tore out all of the carpets because she would trip and fall on the carpet, so there's no more rugs downstairs. And we installed a accessible bathroom with a walk-in tub downstairs because it was only a half bath and a small closet in the front hall, so you can't do much there. Stairs are out of the question. So when Mom had a couple spates of illness, we gradually kind of got her here, and then we had to go through that process of bringing all of the things that she owned that she really needed here and doing something with the other things. And that's a very trying process, because if your parent is like mine, everything is important and nothing should be disposed of, and you have to do these kinds of things. So we were fortunate. We hired some people to do an estate sale who were very reputable, and we were able to go through that process. A couple things motivate me in choosing to do the kinds of things which my wife and I are doing now with my mother. First and foremost, I believe what the scripture says, that you honor your parents. And second of all, you're supposed to do what you want people to do for you. So I'm hoping that my children, I have three, will not necessarily have me come live with them, but if the time comes that I need more care than I'm able or I need more help than I'm able to do on my own, I would at least like to model for them some idea of what I would want them to do for me.
All right, fantastic. So you see there, Bob was talking about the complexity of having his mom come to live with him, and I bet you thought you'd never know somebody that was 100, right? Well, Virginia's going to turn 101 in June, and she's a pretty impressive lady, and that's an impressive number, but what really strikes me as being impressive and just like totally blows my lid is the fact that Bob and Elaine made those decisions, those conscious decisions, to change the way they lived, an adjustment of their lifestyle in order to accommodate his mother. Now, in 1 Timothy 5:3, it says, the church should care for any widow who has no one else to care for her. But, now watch this, but if she has children and grandchildren, circle that, children and grandchildren, their first responsibility is to show godliness at home and repay their parents for taking care of them. This is something that pleases God very much. So when I look at that, it says it doesn't even matter if you're a grandchild, this message is applicable to you, okay? There will come a day, as I said earlier, that your roles will change with your parents. They change. The more your parent needs your help, the more, you know, the more that they invite you into their lives, the roles start to reverse, and that relationship starts to reverse. And there might be some of you that are, you're right in the middle of that right now, and you go, oh, God, she's so right. You know, and then there's some of you guys that are approaching it, and you're looking going, whoa, right? And then there's some of you that are a little younger, and you're just saying, well, that's a future thing. And there's some of you that that element has already passed, but hasn't really. Here's the thing. No matter where you are in your life, you will face with a parent that's aging this place where your roles are going to start to switch. And it is at that time that God is giving you the opportunity, and I want you to seize it, that he's giving you this opportunity to love on them and to give back to them in that season. And he says that when you and I rise up to that challenge, which is so very hard for a lot of reasons, and we do that, it pleases the Father God. He says it pleases him. Now, a little word of advice for those of you that haven't quite got there yet. Listen, you want to start meeting their needs now, today. That's right. You don't want to wait until, you know, they're really old or whatever. You want to start to think through that process. What would that look like? How would I run along with them to help, you know, help them meet their needs? And you start to think mentally and emotionally about that. You're getting yourself ready. And today is Mother's Day. What a great day to start, right? You could call your mother and talk to her and let her know you're doing good and ask her how she's doing. And so if she lives in town, you could, I don't know, take her to lunch or to dinner or to make her something or to cut her grass, to wash her car. You're deciding to meet her needs. And that's a behavior that you first choose to do, and then you start to engage in it. And if you start early, then it becomes natural. As the parent becomes older, it's just natural. You just continue to grow in that behavior. Now, the next decision we're going to suggest that you make to honor your parents is to decide to accept the changes, to accept change. Now, I don't take that for granted, to accept change. I talk about it, how the roles reverse. But, I mean, there is a real mental shift that has to go on when you're dealing with a parent, because they're bigger than life, right? They're your superheroes, and all of a sudden you start to see the human frailty, and it's hard to read the signs as if that are there before you. And Jesus actually spoke about this. He spoke to Peter, his apostle, when he says in John 21:18, I tell you the truth, when you were young, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Loss of control, correct? Now, Jesus was prophesying about what was going to happen to Peter and end life. But there's a principle here that says as we get older, there are changes and we lose a measure of control that we've had all our life that we're used to. And that's hard. That's hard. And so when you're looking at your parent and you're watching them, you have to realize that they are losing control, and that's emotionally taxing on them. And what comes up and out of that is fear. And it's not something that's just one person, you know, feels that. No, that's generally what happens when all of us, when we start losing control of the things around us, fear wants to creep its way in there. And so we have to be able to talk it down, and we have to be able to understand it. Now, I want you to see how Trisha Herzog, another woman in our church who was caring for her mother, how she handled this whole idea of losing control and the mother-daughter switching in their roles. Take a look at this.
Hi, I'm Trisha, and I've been with the Vineyard since its conception. It was hard. You know, it's hard to see my mom not able to take care of herself, not able to get up and move about as much as she used to. I mean, she was always moving. I mean, she would leave us in the wind when she was walking up and down the street and we would be following her. She always was very independent and could take care of herself. And having me take care of her caused the friction because she didn't want it. She would get downright ornery about it and tell me no. And it was almost like she was one of my children, you know, because I was telling her what she had to do and she was giving me, you know, no, I don't want to do that. I don't have to do that. And I would say, yes, Mom, you do have to do this. And we would just go back and forth, and finally she would relent and let me do it, or sometimes she didn't. Sometimes she just didn't. And I had to deal with it, and I just had to live with it.
Okay, so that's adjustments, making adjustments, looking at changes, and knowing that as the parent is aging, that these things are happening, you know, that changes are going about. And to prepare yourself, as well as to run alongside an aging parent, there's a couple of things that you need to get into your mindset, right? And being able to handle changes, you have to do two things in my mind. The first is to release the dreams that you had of what it was supposed to look like when somebody passes away, or that end life experience, you know? And the other one is to be able to handle guilt that wants to come rushing in. You know, that first one about dreams, we all have dreams and ideas about how things are supposed to go. We might even have prayed about them and we feel certain that this is how it's going to go. But I'm going to tell you, after ministering for so long, that I see that dreams rarely match reality. The dreams that we have rarely match the reality. And so what that can happen is it can just cause all kinds of pain to come up, and this dissonance in your mind, you know, in your heart. Like, wait a minute, Lord. You know, I thought we were going to go this way. And so what I have found is in the dream that you have, to recognize it just for what it is. It's just a dream. It's an idea. It's what you wanted to happen. And then there's reality of what is happening. And there's this place where you go before the Lord and you say, God, I wanted it this way, but I understand that it's going this way, and I trust you in that. And so there's this giving of your dream to the Lord and giving it to him. Because if you've prayed for something for so long and so hard and you believed it and it didn't come, if you do not take care of that, then the root of bitterness comes up. And it's hard for you to give care and to walk that out, that part of your life out. The next thing I talked to you about was guilt. Hey, listen, there's no subject that quite brings up guilt in people than this one when I start talking about how we're going to take care of our aging parents. It seems to have guilt just rush right in. Even Bob, who was the first interview I did, you heard him. He's been taking care of his mom all of his life. Yet there's still, well, if I would have had her live with me when she was, you know, 90 instead of 95, right? And stuff. And so you hear this, gosh, I feel guilty. I should have done something else. Like, you could have changed the fact that somebody's getting older, that changes are taking place, and they're not. And so when that happens and you're doing what you can for your parent and that hits, then just know that emotion is not so much guilt as disappointment. Like, gosh, I wanted it to be better. I wish it wouldn't have had to be like this. And so you can kind of reframe it. All right? And it's at that place I'm going to point you right back to Jesus and say, go there and talk to him about that and release that. So what about, Sharon, if you generally have guilt because you were not there for your parent? You know, you chose other things and inside you're like, oh. Well, I want to talk to you about that too. Because here you go. Those of us that are Christ followers, we serve a forgiving God. We serve a God that loves us. And if we come with our shortcomings, because I know I've done it so many times when I've blown it, and I come and I talk to him, I say, I'm sorry, I blew it, I did this, I was selfish, or I chose incorrectly, or I was confused and I made bad decisions. Do you know what Jesus says? It's okay, I forgive you. And he takes that and he throws it as far as the east is to the west. And so again, when we have these feelings pushing in that feel like guilt, I'm going to point you to the cross. I'm going to point you to Jesus Christ. And when you're accepting the changes that are going around you in a household where you have an aging parent, you've got to be able to deal with the dreams that you had that aren't realized, or the guilt, those feelings that you're having. The next decision that you make here is to be able to share the load. I'm going to suggest that you share the load. You know, when we start talking about taking care of an aging parent, the first thing that we hit is like, oh no, financially, what's this going to do? My time, how's that going to push in? My relationships with my family, you know, my spouse, my kids, my grandkids, you know, what's going to happen with all that? And so we start to think through like it's going to impact me, you know, at an exponential level. And I want to tell you that nobody says it has to be all you, Okay? You need to know that you've got to share the load. You've got to have other people involved in that caring of the parent. It could be other family members. It could be church folks. It could be, people who are in the community that help us with agencies in town and things like that. All of them work on your team. You just need to know you need to ask and go looking for that. Now watch how this next video, Taryn Church, actually came to that conclusion. Watch this.
Hi, I'm Taryn. I've been at Vineyard for almost 2 years now. My heart, certainly, and I don't think I'm alone, but I don't think we are built for this. I don't think that one person can carry the weight of watching your parent die. And so the importance of that spiritual community to not only speak life to you and remind you who you are, but to be praying for you and to be there when it's not good and when you get glimpses of hope and then when the hope's gone is incredibly important in walking this out successfully and healthily. And I would tell anyone that.
Okay. In Galatians 6:2, it says, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. God has put a team of people around you, people that care about you, but you need to ask, you need to look, and know that people around you want to help you. And so you need to formulate those questions and start asking people to help you, to come and to be part of your team, and so that you can give care to people. Now, one of the stories I came across that I saw this happening was with Nancy Stansbury. She was being called upon to take care of her stepmother, and she was working with her sisters. And I like the way they work, and they handled the very difficult emotions that came up. Take a look at this one.
Hi, my name is Nancy, and I am part of the Vineyard family here at Vineyard Community Church. I'm also part of a blended family. My mother and father divorced, and before they did that, of course, they had 4 children. A few years later, my dad, who was in the Navy, was deployed. He met a lady, a German lady, who had just gotten fresh off the boat here in the United States, and who couldn't even speak English. She only spoke German, and he married her. So when people would ask about our family, my parents would say, yes, we have 7 kids. So being part of a blended family put me as the oldest in a group, actually, and so that's the way we were treated. So my whole life as a child was spent as feeling like I was the redheaded stepchild. By the time I graduated from high school, I decided that I was moving, and I moved all the way to Phoenix, Arizona. Dad came off a deployment, and he took the rest of the family and moved here to Virginia Beach. One of the things that my dad taught me was how to take care of his mother. He would spend every summer with her. He would take the family. We would go to Piggott, Arkansas, and there he would do whatever he needed to take care of her house or anything else that she needed done. Later on, when she became unable to take care of herself, he hired a companion, a neighbor that was lived close by, and she would go in and take care of my grandmother. And that showed me as a child that there was a very important thing to do was to take care of your parents. During my childhood, I built up quite a bit of resentment, but later on, through some counseling, I was able to forgive my stepmother for all the hardships. But it really wasn't until even later than that that I took a trip with some friends of mine to Europe, and my stepmom was there in Germany at the time. And I realized that a lot of the reasons that she seemed to be so hard and so mean, I used to say she's so mean, it was that it was the German culture, the very starch way that she talked, and also that I found out too that she went through a lot of hardship during the Second World War as a child living in Germany. So I was able then to just forgive her for all the things that I hated about her. And slowly and surely then I was able to love her more and more. But really I loved her the most because she took such good care of my dad. A few weeks ago, my sister Gina called me and asked me if I would come up and help her in Fredericksburg to take care of my stepmom. She needed to get out of town and because of her job. So I did go up there. And one of the mornings I was sitting there waiting for my stepmom to wake up, and I was looking around, and all in her room were pictures of her and my dad and their two daughters, and there was a family reunion picture with all of us there, and there was a picture of them together, and you could tell how much in love they were. And I really just started missing my dad. One of the frustrations that I have with this whole thing of taking care of my stepmom is that, you know, will she be with Jesus when she goes? And that was something that my sister Gina and I talked about. And we remembered then that as a child, she was raised in the Lutheran Church. And she made sure that all of her children were confirmed in the Lutheran Church. So we decided that, you know, once saved, always saved. So we will see her in heaven when the time comes.
Now, in that video that you just saw there, I love the fact that Nancy works with her sister to resolve issues that she has in her heart, and that she really reframes, even though she has a stepmother, that she was able to step over a lot of barriers. And as Taryn had said earlier, we are not designed to do this thing on our own. We really do need people around us to help encourage us. So the next decision I want to lead you to is this decision of being able to say, I'm going to have a balanced life. I'm going to balance my life. See, when we're taking care of somebody else, it can become pretty weighty, you know, when they have a lot of needs, and so you're meeting their physical needs, you know, and you're trying to help them with their spiritual needs and their mental needs and their emotional. And then all of a sudden, you get out of balance if you do not take care of yourself and you do not restore yourself and make sure you have this rest and that you have the sleep that you need. And Jesus talks about this balance in Mark 12:31. He says, love others as well as you would love yourself. And so you can circle love others and love self. You need a balance in order to give people what they need, especially when you're working with an aging parent. Now, again, I've asked Taryn to speak on this balance issue because she found it as she was caring for her father before he passed. Take a look at this one.
You can't completely put yourself and your life aside or on hold during this season. If I could go back and tell myself the Taryn in 2010 to eat well and get enough water and sleep and have a life outside of doctor's offices and medication and just to really care for self and mostly spiritually, to be surrounded by people that fill you up because you're giving so much, that it's so important to be full enough to be able to give.
You know, this concept reminds me of when I get on an airplane to go flying. You know, the little stewardess comes up and she instructs us if there's a change in the cabin pressure, right, and those oxygen masks drop off, that we are to put it on ourselves before trying to assist somebody. And so there's this idea of balance that you have to be able to put it on yourself because you have to be able to breathe. If you're not breathing, you're not living, you're not existing. You really can't help somebody else. And so this idea of balance is so very central when you're helping to take care of aging parents. So the next decision I want to bring up and have you look at is this one of expecting to grow during this season. Expect to grow because that's what's going to happen. James 1:3-4 says, you know that under pressure, your faith life is forced out into the open, shows its true colors. So don't try to get out of anything permanent prematurely. Let it Let it do its work so you can become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. And so I'm going to talk to you about what God can do in those hard places. But before I do, I want to make this little note, side note. If you are presently here today and you are giving care with somebody at end stages of their life, you have my permission right this minute to just click out of what I'm going to say here, okay? Because I know personally, when you are in that place, you do not need to hear that God's trying to grow you. You need to climb inside of God's hands. You need to allow him to love you and pull you close inside. You don't need to be focused on what you're learning. Now, with that said, those of us who have walked through some real painful places in our lives, right? It's at those times that God has our attention. It's at those times of difficulty that God can really open our eyes up to see truth. It's at those times that God can really challenge us to rise up and be children of the God Most High. And what does that look like? And so it's at those times he can talk to us. And I want you to see somebody who's reflected back now, Trisha Herzog. Her mom has now since gone. She took care of her for 7 years. But look at the richness at which Trisha learned through that experience. Watch this.
I think one thing that I want to say is that when I was able to forgive my mother, God restored something in my brain. I don't know what it is. It sounds crazy, but all I can remember before that happened is all the bad things that had happened, all the arguments, all the, you know, that's all I could think about. That's how I related to my mother. But when that fell off, God starts showing me things about my mother, that she was beautiful, that she was smart, that she gardened, that she loved her grandchildren, that, you know, she stayed with her husband and loved him for over 40-some years, and she was a hard worker. And I never noticed those things beforehand because all I was concerned with was me and what was going on with me. And God had me look at my mom's background and realize that there was things that she didn't learn as a child. She didn't learn how to give affection to her children because it wasn't given to her. And it just, that was one of the things that I think I broke. And I, it's a generational gap, I broke that because I wanted my girls to know love. Matter of fact, sometimes I love them too much, but I would hug them and I would love them and I would encourage them and I would tell them the good things that they're doing. And that's something I learned from my mom. Not that she, no longer do I think my mom is, you know, this person who couldn't love me. I just think of her as a person that was broken and that she didn't know how to love. And God showed me how to love her. For those 7 years, I was able to love my mom in a way that we never had before. I was able to hold her and say, I love you. I was able to hold her and tell her it was okay. I was able to hold her and say, Mom, you can do this.
So you see, Trisha was leaning into the Lord. And as she pressed into him in that time of need, his image began to be actually put back on her. And she was able to give forgiveness and love. And she found the power to step over years of sadness in that relationship. That's what God does. He grows us in that season when we're giving care to a parent who's aging. The next decision you have to make, and really it undergirds all of the decisions, is that you have to decide to trust God. You have to trust him. In Matthew 11:28, it says, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. You see, that's the call of the Holy Spirit even today. When you came in here, it could be other things that are going on in your life, but God is calling to you to yoke up with him, to walk with him, to trust him. Now, if you're like me, you know, whenever I hit a wall, something happens and there's a wall and I smash into it, I'm the queen of climbing over that wall, right? I don't let anything defeat me. I don't like it. I give it my best effort. But do you know, there are things that you're going to hit. There's going to be walls that you're going to hit that you are not able to climb over in your own power. You just can't do them. And death is one of them. It's a fact. 100% of you will die. Okay? If you were uncertain about it, right? 100%, that's going to happen. And when we hit that wall of death with people that we love, you got two choices. You can run and try to find a lower wall, try to self-medicate, make yourself feel better. Or you can look at that wall and you can admit that that wall is just too high for you to get over. It's too big. You cannot, you know, you can't go over it on your own strength. And so there's where I'm going to say that you want to appeal to something and somebody that's higher than the wall, which is Jesus Christ. It's at that place that you turn to him who is higher than death itself, because he offers us resurrection, okay? He offers us joining back with people that go before us. And we need to know that, and we need to walk in certainty with that, always keeping that close to us. So this relationship with this God that I'm talking about through his son, Jesus Christ, it's not about coming and being part of this church or going to any church. It's about embracing an intimacy with the God who has provided us his very son so that we could walk close with him. And let me tell you, when you are facing these huge walls of working with parents whom we love, and that death comes knocking at the door, you are going to need something. Now take a look at this last video with Taryn, and then we'll talk.
So spiritually, during that season, again, I had left the church that I was a part of and was scrambling for support and for a new church family, and really had to pull on the investment of the Word and our relationship that I had made, my relationship with God at that time. The biggest memory I have spiritually during that time is I was outside mowing, and my dad, they lived in a beautiful home facing a lake, and he sat at this huge picture window. And so when I would go away from the house, I was weeping. I just was broken. And when I would turn around and come back, I had to get myself together, because he would sit at that window and I knew he was probably watching. And I remember praying, just for an answer. Just, God, is he gonna get through this? Is he gonna be okay, or is he not? It was the unknowing. It was just the unknown of how much longer would he have to go through this? Would we have to go through this? And the answer I got was, my grace is sufficient for you. Whether he goes or whether he stays, my grace is sufficient for you. So as my heart is breaking, I still knew and now know that his grace has been sufficient through that huge loss and through that grief that I had no idea the weight that it would be. But here I am talking about it. His grace has been sufficient and will be.
Your grace is sufficient, O Lord. How true a statement. You know, it's those places that we realize when God drops a verse in our heart, that it comes to be exactly what we need to get through things. And so this, again, this kind of relationship, this intimacy relationship, you all need it. I need it, right? And so if you don't have this place of surrender and asking Jesus Christ to be the leader of your life, today after this message, I'm going to close this in prayer, and I'm going to give you an opportunity. Establish it, reestablish it. You cannot face life successfully and come out whole without this kind of relationship. Now, the last verse I want to share with you is in Isaiah 43:2, and this is a promise that God gives us and one I hold on to. When you pass through the deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you. When you pass through fire, you will not be burned. The hard trials that come will not hurt you. And so God doesn't promise us that there is not going to be deep waters and there's not going to be fires. But he does promise us here that he will never leave us nor forsake us, that he will scoop us up and carry us to the place that we need to be. Bow your heads with me, and I'm going to close this in prayer. Father, I thank you for your spirit here tonight, Father. Lord, you are so faithful. You are so faithful. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would just speak right now. When we slow our hearts and our minds down, Father, come and talk. Come and talk, Father. Come and share to those hearts that are searching. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Okay, in my heart I can see there's some of you that have had parents go on and you've just felt such a void. And this has been so hard to hear because it's bringing up all that sadness. And so this morning, I want to lift you up right now, wherever you are. Father, I ask that you'd go there and that you would soothe that pain that they feel, Lord God. That you would reframe what took place. That you would breathe your hope and your word into it. I thank you for that, Lord. And the Father would have each and every one of you to have this intimate exchange that I've been talking about. And so if you don't have that kind of relationship, he's inviting you to have that. Right where you're at right now, the Father will accept you. He will love you because he sees you through his Son, Jesus Christ. But he'll never force himself on you. You must ask him to come and be part of your life. And so for those of you that want that, just right where you're at, you just pray this prayer. God is listening. You just say, Father God, I don't understand everything, but I want that intimacy. I want you to talk to me that way. I want the comfort that you have to give. And so I accept your Son, Jesus Christ, as my Savior, and I ask him to become the leader of my life. From this day forward, I will call you my King and my Lord. Father, those that were praying that prayer, Lord, I ask that you'd seal it in their heart, and I know you wrote their name in the book of life that you have. I thank you for them, Lord. And Father, we all desire, Father, to answer that angst inside of us, to lovingly care for our parents, and to reconcile the emotions. Yeah, reconcile those emotions with what your word says. And so, Father, I bring this congregation before you. Just as you have given us direction to talk about the fun things of falling in love and having children and, yes, of growing old together. And then you pinged us with, it's full circle. And you expect us to parent our parents. And so, Father, I ask that you would give us what we need, that you could mark us a people that knew how to love well, and that we especially took care of those that were aging, Father. And so, Lord, I give you all that I have. I give you all that I am, as limited as it is, Lord. And I ask that you would become our sufficiency in that endeavor. And Father, again, I ask for your soothing love and your patience and your kindness in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.